Well, hello everyone. Hello all the bird fans, bird freaks, bird geeks, and everyone that is here. Even the cartoonists that might have never seen a bird. For those of you that are on the chat already, I'm loving that you kind of were into Kipo. Kipo is one of my favorite shows, and I'm very glad I'm here. Hola, hola a todos. My name is Andres. I am the Urban Program Coordinator for Birds Canada, and welcome to this fifth annual Toronto Bird Celebration 2021. I am totally thrilled to be here, and I'm totally thrilled for today's event. But first, we start by connecting to the land, acknowledging that Toronto is situated on Indigenous land and the Dish with One Spoon territory. This is the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, Wendat, and the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nations. We also acknowledge that Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. Birds Canada gratefully acknowledges these Indigenous nations for their guardianship of this beautiful land. Let us know where you're tuning from. As I mentioned before, Rosemary is here with us, and she wants you to know that you need a notebook and some pieces of paper, so start getting those. I'm joined by Rosemary, who should turn her camera pretty soon. Hi, Rosemary.
Hi.
Where are you tuning from, Rosemary?
I am in the U.S. Northeast, the unspecified U.S. Northeast.
Rosemary Moscow is the creator of the acclaimed nature cartoon Bird and Moon and the author of many science books for children and adults. She also co-wrote the New York Times bestselling book, The Atlas Obscura, Explorer's Guide to the World's Most Adventurous Kid. She has worked with scientists and organizations to produce cartoons that educate and entertain while promoting bird conservation. Rosemary, where is the name Bird and Moon from?
It's from my very first cartoon that I made when I was living in Toronto a few years ago. It was called Bird and Moon, and it was about a lonely bird that meets and makes friends with the moon.
Awesome.
Yeah. Toronto.
Thank you for that. I would also like to give a shout out and ask you to connect with champions, the bird champions that make this event free and possible. TD, Friends for the Environment Foundation, Armstrong Bird Food, Accord Advertising, Patterson Outdoor, and Kowa Birding Optics. Remember that our quest for the celebrities is ongoing. You might have seen a picture before. If you spot birds in the GTA and tag Birds Canada and Tea Over Party, you can join the contest for Fjeld Raven prizes and Firefly books. Big shout out to these guys providing the swag for this awesome contest. You might notice that we are not doing a webinar today as we traditionally do in the Toronto Bird Celebration. We're having a Zoom meeting. So I would like to kind of get familiarized. You guys will be able to start your cameras and to start your microphones because Rosemary desires it. So let's give it a try with our cameras. Turn on the cameras, those of you that feel comfortable and that are in the US, and turn off the cameras, whoever else is not in the US. Come on, I'll give you 5 seconds. Cameras on for US people. Hello, US people. All right, cameras on for Portugal people. Cameras off for the rest. I see cameras going out. Oh, I see someone for Portugal. Oh, that's awesome. Cool. I really wanted to do that. All right. Cameras on for those that are Canadian or that are in Canada. Oh my God, so many of you. Hello, everyone. It's great to see you. Oh, Joanne is here. Hey, Joanne.
There's a parrot.
Yeah. Oh, there's a parrot. Oh my God. This is turning out to be one of the best webinars ever. Okay. Cameras off to those of you. Cameras on to those of you that are birders. Any kind of birder, you know, from you know, partner of a birder or someone that gets so much bird information from a friend to seasoned birder. Okay. Now, cameras on to those of you that are artists and that like drawing, taking photos, making cartoons. Wow, we have a lot of artists.
Ooh.
Okay. So now you know, you can have your camera, you can have your microphones. I will ask you to have your microphones muted until the person next to me, well, maybe on the other side, depending on where you're looking at, Rosemary tells you to. And without further ado, they are all yours, Rosemary.
All right. Thank you so much. Man, it is so exciting to see people from all over the place. I'm originally from Canada, so I miss Canada so much, but so many cool places. Okay, so let's get started. So make sure that you have a few scrap pieces of paper because we're going to do some exercises. Let me just move my little window here. All right. So I am Rosemary Mosco. I am a cartoonist and a science communicator. And today we're going to learn how to make comics about birds. So I have been bird obsessed for pretty much my entire life, ever since I was able to figure out how to use a set of binoculars and pick my my Halloween costumes. Here I'm trying to be a green-winged macaw. And I like that birds can be very serious and very serene and, you know, thought-provoking, but that they can also be extremely ridiculous. And you can use that humor to help people love and understand birds. So what we're going to do today, like I mentioned, is we're going to learn how to some tips for making comics. But comics are really complicated. They are writing, they're drawing, they're humor. The ones that I do are also, you know, some field studying and stuff. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to break it down into little pieces and just give you some fun exercises that will hopefully kind of get you into the comics groove. So how it's going to work is I'm going to start by introducing myself and giving a really quick little talk about what I do and why I think it's great to use comics to talk about birds. Then we're going to do some drawing and some writing exercises, and don't be intimidated. They're really fun. And then with the time that remains, we're going to get you started making a comic. It takes me a long time to make comics, so you might not be able to finish something in the time that you have. But if you finish it outside of the workshop, please email it to me because I love seeing that. So I mentioned that I am a science communicator, and that's someone who bridges the gap between scientists and the public. So I speak with scientists, I find out what they want to communicate, I speak with the public, I find out what they want to communicate, and I act as basically a bridge, which sounds really cool, but what on earth does this mean in terms of an actual job? Also, I just want to say I love that there's a parrot listening to this. This makes me so happy, little Amazon. My parrots are in the other room. Otherwise, they'll be biting me while I use the keyboard. So this has taken me to some pretty strange places. I've gotten to go out and experience all sorts of cool wildlife. I've gotten to do some really fun graphics, like this Art Nouveau illustration of an indigo snake, and some articles for Audubon down here in the States. I spend most of my time making books and not cartoons. So I have a bunch of books out. The one in the middle bottom is the one that just came out, which is a picture book about disgusting butterfly science that I'm really proud of, called Butterflies Are Pretty Gross. It's published through Tundra, which is a Canadian publisher, so pretty cool. And then I have one coming out in the fall that might interest you that's about pigeons, called A Pocket Guide to Pigeon Watching. And then I have a bunch of other stuff coming out. Which is why there's dot, dot, dot. I've been busy. I need a vacation. Most people know me from my cartoons and my charts, though, and I put them online on a website called birdandmoon.com. So I'm going to run through two of my cartoons so you can get an idea of sort of what's possible here. So I'm going to start with the latest one that I did. So a lot of birds have really baffling names. You may have noticed this if you're getting into birding. You see these names and you think, why did they name it that? And one of those is the nuthatches. There's many nuthatch species. Y'all probably see white-breasted nuthatches, folks who are in Canada or in the Northeast. And you know, you look at this bird and you think, okay, it has a white breast, that makes sense, but why the nut hatch part? So it turns out that nut hatch kind of comes from older English, and it's sort of a definition of hatch that is similar to hack. So what they do, this is a Eurasian nut hatch, is they cram nuts in like a crevice in the tree and use the tree as a tool to help them crack open the nut. But I was thinking, what if there was another way that they got their name? So this is a nut hatch. It's called a nuthatch because, wait, no, that's not, wait, No. That was really fun because I got to learn to draw nuts, which I didn't really know how to do. So they don't actually hatch baby nuts. And here's another comic. So like a lot of bird watchers, I take a lot of photos, and on very rare occasions, they even turn out okay. Here's one that I was really proud of. We had this eruption of common redpoles down in the US. You know, folks in Canada see them a lot more, but I was so excited to see them. I got this lucky shot of this redpole looking at me. But the vast majority of my photos turn out really badly. So every spring I go out and take a bunch of terrible photos of warblers, and you may find this resembles you. So here is a beautiful photo I just took the other day of a black and white warbler. And the only part that's in focus is the perch where the black and white warbler was previously inhabiting. And then I'm about to show you the worst photo I've ever taken in my life. So I apologize if you don't want to see a cloaca, please do not look. So here we go. So this is the best shot I've ever taken of an oven bird, which is also a warbler, and it is pooping in my direction. Incredible timing on that photo. Oh. So here's the comic I made. It's called A Guide to Bird Photography. And on the left, you'll see the photo that you want to get. And on the right, the photo that you'll get. So you want to get a well-framed shot. And what you'll get is an action shot. You want to get a bird in sharp focus, but what you will instead get is exquisite leaf detail. You want to get a striking portrait. And instead, you will just get the kingbird that is mobbing the hawk that you're trying to take a picture of. And finally, you want to get a picture of pure elegance, and instead you get, maybe I can fix this in post. There are so many videos online of herons pooping because they poop right before they take off, and people go to film them, and then they take off and they drop a load to kind of, make it lighter so they can fly, which I love. So real quick, how did I become a nature cartoonist and why? Well, I grew up in Ottawa, and it's nice to talk to a lot of Canadians because you'll actually know what Ottawa is, the capital of Canada. If you like the outdoors, it's a great place to be. And growing up, I spent a lot of time outside, and I had this real kind of double love. I loved science, especially biology and the outdoors, and I loved art. And when I wasn't outside, kayaking and canoeing in my grandpa's cottage on Norway Bay, I was reading cartoons, especially newspaper cartoons, things like Calvin and Hobbes or The Far Side. And I was making my own drawings that combined these things. So here's a drawing I made of a skating party. So all these birds I knew, are having this party, and there's a loon on the top right, and there's a peacock and a mute swan. And I was really proud of this drawing. So I really loved science and art, and I wanted to grow up to do both. And I kept hitting roadblocks because a lot of people think that science and art are incompatible. But as time went on, I realized that they're wrong about that, and that people have been mixing science and art for hundreds of years. So here are a few quick examples. This is a beautiful drawing from 1596 of the first flush toilet. Sir John Harrington is an ancestor of Kit Harrington from Game of Thrones, in case you want a piece of trivia. This is, so Antony von Leeuwenhoek was one of the earliest microscope users, and he loved to basically look at anything, no matter how gross, under a microscope. And here he scraped some bits of goo between his teeth, and he looked at it and he saw critters swimming around. So pretty gross from 1695. Of course, the ornithology world has a long history of mixing art and science. So on the left is beautiful art by Elizabeth Gould that she used to illustrate the birds that her husband John Gould was finding, this famous ornithologist. On the right, Alex Warnick is one of my all-time favorite modern bird artists. She does spectacular watercolors and, all for science. And I always lean too heavily on the visual art, and I really shouldn't. So there's, of course, many ways that you can communicate science artistically. And Camille T. Dungy and Mary Oliver are two poets who have combined the natural world with their art. So I eventually found a graduate program that mixed science and art called the Field Naturalist Program at the University of Vermont. And I was so lucky to find this combo. And afterwards, I tried all sorts of different ways to communicate science, but I just kept coming back to comics. So the thing is that when you mix art and science, comics really have a special part to play. So one giant secret of comics is that you probably read them all the time without knowing it. If you have any friends who say, well, I don't read comics, it is not true because they definitely do. So when you get on an airplane, you're handed a comic book, and it's not a very fun or exciting comic book, but it is designed to keep you safe on an airplane. And the reason they use cartoons is because a lot of people learn really well from that simple format of a cartoon. Similarly, I'm sure we're all sick of looking at these, but especially in the early phases of the pandemic, we were all looking at these hand washing diagrams. And I would argue that these are pretty much cartoons. They have the same structure, these boxes, sequential art, lots of very carefully chosen text, really, really cartoony. And again, that's for a reason. So that magical combination of art, text, and boxes, and sometimes humor can really help people learn. And I'm going to end this little intro with this little story. So my friend Kelsey recently became a birder just a couple of years ago. And she grew up reading Calvin and Hobbes. And she remembered this one strip where Calvin is filling out a crossword puzzle and he gets a 5-letter word and the clue is bird. And so he tries to cram yellow-bellied sapsucker in there, which I feel like birders could all relate. And it's great. And it also taught my friend what a yellow-bellied sapsucker was. And just recently, she got to see her first yellow-bellied sapsucker, and she was so excited. And that was a direct line between these cartoons and her birding experience. So that's my little intro. And now we're going to do some exercises. So what we're going to start with is drawing. So grab some scrap paper. And we'll get ready in a pen. You don't need anything fancy. So comics are packed with art. And, you know, I can sometimes be a slow artist. So sometimes it helps me to do some warm-up exercises, which make me work a little speedier. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to share a sentence. And I can't remember if it's one or two. It's two sentences. Okay. And we're going to draw what it says, and you're going to draw it in 2 minutes. So in 3 seconds, I'm going to show you the sentence. Okay, so go. So it is, an eagle flies over the ocean carrying a big fish, but it accidentally drops the fish. A shark jumps out of the water to try and grab the fish. So you now have 1 minute and 47 seconds. So again, an eagle flies over the ocean carrying a big fish, but it accidentally drops the fish. A shark jumps out of the water to try and grab the fish. Don't have to be super anatomically correct. So you've got a minute and 20 seconds. Doing great. So if you've already sketched a lot of it out, try to add, you know, maybe some teeth in your shark, maybe some talons on your eagle, maybe specify what kind of fish it is. Okay, you've got one more minute. Doing great. Maybe pick which eagle you want. Oh my goodness, Andres is already showing off his art. I'm sad I won't be able to see all of you in a gallery format because it's always fun to see what people draw. Okay, you've got 30 seconds left. So add any nice little details. Oh, I'm seeing, yeah, very nice. Ooh, excellent. Very good, shark. Okay, we've got 15 seconds. I'm sure some of you are just sitting there thinking, really, we've got that much time left? I'm already all set.
I really want to see everyone's drawing. Mine is definitely not something to put in a museum.
Okay, time is up. I guess I can check the grid, and if anyone wants to hold up their sketches, we can see. Oh, these are so good. Oh, excellent. Oh my goodness. Okay. Well, hold that thought, because we are going to do it again with the same sentence, but you are only going to have 1 minute. Are you ready? And go. 1 minute, same sentence. So, or two sentences. An eagle flies over the ocean carrying a big fish, but it accidentally drops the fish. A shark jumps out of the water to try and grab the fish. You have 45 seconds. You can do it. Much simpler this time. Omit some details, maybe fewer teeth on your shark. Right. You have 30 seconds. You got this. Got some browns. Some folks are already, wow, my goodness. Some folks are already done.
Mine is not something to put in the art gallery.
Let's see. Oh my goodness, but you still got some time if you want to add any details. We've got 15 seconds. I think it looks great. I can tell that's an eagle. That's excellent. Okay. And 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and stop.
Can you tell this is an eagle?
So you can probably
tell more it was an eagle there, but they're both good.
You can probably tell that it's getting a little bit trickier, but you did a great job. You did a great job. Okay. So we're gonna do it again. And you are only going to have 30 seconds. Go. Okay. Super, super simple details, nothing too complicated. Lots and lots of quick, broad shapes. Super simple. You're doing great. You have about 10 seconds.
Seagull.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, let's see it. Let's see what we got. Ooh, you also don't have to share. You are not required to share. Oh, excellent. Oh, great. Okay. I am really sorry to say that we're going to do this one more time. Okay. And we are going to do the same thing in 10 seconds. You ready? Go. Okay. 10 seconds. Same thing. Eagle, fish, shark. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and stop. Okay, did anybody get all of the characters in that 10 second drawing? Wow, okay. Excellent. Oh, okay. So you see what a lot of you did was you really simplified your forms and you made it just so you've got your gesture. Yeah. Oh, excellent. Okay. So great. Oh, this is a delight to see. All right. Okay. Take a break. Take a breath. That was very stressful. Nothing else in this workshop is going to be that stressful, I promise. You did an excellent job. All right, so let's move on to trying to draw a few birds. So I'm a little stressed and I didn't draw anything. You did a great job. So drawing birds is obviously a really, really big and complicated topic that I can't cover in, you know, the short time we have together. So I'm going to try to give you just some general broad tips about it. For drawing birds, I can't recommend enough this book by John Muir Laws called The Laws Guide to Drawing Birds. Really, really excellent book. It'll fill in all the blanks. He does workshops sometimes too through California Audubon, really great. And John Muir Laws suggests that the way you start a bird drawing is to start with simple shapes and lines, and then you can build up your bird from there. And there's a good reason for that. You know, sometimes if you start with a detail, then you focus on another detail, you won't see how they're all connected. So, I just realized I changed the word draw to make. That's fine. So let's take a look at this common bird that we all see pretty often, a black-capped chickadee. And if you were to look at which shapes you can see in this bird, I think we would all agree they would be something sort of similar to this. So we would see, usually there's a big round ball for the body, smaller ball for the head, and some lines that show you where the bill is, where the tail is, where the feet are. By the way, the words bill and beak mean the same thing, and don't let anyone tell you that you're using the wrong one. Please send any complaints to rmosco@gmail.com. So now we're going to look at another bird that looks quite different from our chickadee. And what I want you to do is just try to sketch out just really fast the general shapes that you see, just the shapes. So just try sketching this bird. So this is a very differently shaped bird. Obviously, it's got a really long neck. Tricolored herons are more found in the south. They're some of my favorites because they've got that mix of blue and purple and white on them with the three colors. So, you know, just try to generally sketch out lines for the legs, ball for the head, ball for the body, the general shape of the neck, the general shape of the bill. We'll just go for another few seconds. Okay. All right. So here is roughly what I would do if I was looking at this bird. I would draw a circle for the head. I would draw kind of a jagged line showing the neck. And this is a really good way to start because then you know that you can fit your bird into your whole page. Oh, I'm seeing some good shapes. Excellent. So let's try it one more time. This is a red-shouldered hawk that I saw down in Florida, forest hawk. And again, we're gonna try drawing the shape. So this is a way different bird. It's really kind of oval shaped. So just draw the broad shapes that you see. So maybe circle for the head, any sort of shapes that you think might be useful for you to kind of draw a map of this bird. So just general shapes. Give you a few more seconds, nothing too complicated. Okay, so let's take a look. So this is how I would do it, is probably a sort of a rectangle-y kind of shape or wedge shape for the tail. Again, this is super, super simple stuff, but it'll save you a mountain of trouble if you start drawing with those shapes. So a few other things to know about birds, and you're welcome to keep working on your hawk and your tricolored heron while I talk. So I suggest you should take a closer look at the anatomy of your birds and think about the reason why the bird has each part, because each part has a purpose. So this is a really wild bird that lives along the East Coast, usually doesn't get as high up as Canada. Sometimes, you know, you'll see it a lot in Florida. You'll see it higher up the coast too. This is a black skimmer and they have a really long lower bill and a smaller upper bill, and they just don't look real. And if you just looked at this bird without understanding its life habits, you'd think, you know, what on earth? So I'm going to show you a video of this bird. I love the music. So this is a skimmer feeding. So check out what it does. It flies really low, and then it's gonna dip the long lower bill into the water and skim. And then when it feels a fish, snap it up. So, so, so cool. Another thing, so I saw a parrot here earlier. Parrots, you will know, parrots in the audience, that, you know, bird feet are not always what you expect. So a lot of us draw three toes in the front, maybe one toe in the back, but some birds have different arrangements. So parrots, for example, have what are called zygodactyl feet, which is one of my favorite words. And that means they have two toes in front and two toes in back. So to make your bird art a little more accurate, take a look at the feet and what the feet tell you about the bird. Again, let's look back at our tricolored heron. If we take a look at this bird, there's so much we can learn just from its body. So it's got that long stabbing bill. It's got that spring-loaded neck for shooting its head forward to stab fish. And those legs, you know, they're more than just really cool looking. They are to keep the bird from getting too wet and keep it kind of elevated up above the water so that it doesn't get super drenched. So it all has a purpose. Another thing to ask yourself is, what is a bird doing? Birds really change how they look depending on what they're doing. And you'll notice here, this green heron can go from a round bird to a long bird in not that much time. Similarly, this is a great Argus pheasant or great Argus. It goes from being a long bird to basically being a big round pile of feathers when it's showing off to a female, which is just incredible. Also pay attention to the colors and patterns. So sometimes male and female birds have different colors, not always. You'll see this bird all over where you live, house sparrows, and it's worth taking a look to see how many males and females you can find. On the left here is a male house sparrow, and it looks really different from the female house sparrow that's on the right. And sometimes young ones can look pretty similar to the females too. But bird color gets even cooler. So this is a bird that you're probably familiar with, and it changes color between the summer and the winter. So take a second to try to think what species of bird this might be. So spoiler, it is an American goldfinch. So American goldfinches in the winter look totally different from how they look in the summer, which I think is just so cool. Birds also change color depending on how the light's hitting them. So here's an Anna's hummingbird, and depending on the direction of the light, it may be dark or it may be purple. So it goes almost all black. And then in a second, whoosh, totally purple, incredible. I love birds. So we're going to take just a couple of minutes to try drawing some very normal, not at all strange birds. Extremely normal. Get ready to be super bored by these birds. So don't forget to start with the shapes. Look at the anatomy of the bird. Ask yourself what the bird is doing and think about the colors and patterns. So here is our first super normal, not at all strange bird. So I just learned that I've been saying this bird wrong all my life. It's not a jacana, it's a jasana. So I've been practicing how to say it. Jasana. And they live in Central and South America and in Africa. And they're really, really cool. I think some of them live in Asia too. So what these birds do with their ginormous feet is they walk around on the surfaces of water and lily pads. So try to sketch, and I'll just give you a couple minutes. I wish we had more time, but just a couple minutes to just sketch out this bird, this totally normal bird. I wish I had those feet. So very small round body, very, very large, cool feet. These birds will carry their babies around under their wings, and they'll have all these wild feet sticking out from under their wings. Very, very cool. Okay, so I'll give you another about 30 seconds because we're gonna need to keep rolling. I know we're doing a lot in here. Comics just have so many different parts to them. Okay. All right. So we're going to switch and we're going to draw one more totally normal looking bird. Now, this is another one that I've seen people pronounce in all sorts of different ways. Potu. Very, very normal looking bird with totally normal eyes. Definitely does not look like the way I look when I'm trying to wake up in the morning and I don't want to. So just take another minute or so and just sketch this little friend here. So start with the shapes, think about the anatomy. Notice that, so this is a bird that gulps down insects. Notice it has a giant mouth. Those big eyes, because it's pretty much nocturnal. The colors are because it likes to blend in with wood and pretend that it's not there. Okay, so we're gonna have to keep rolling, but feel free to finish up your sketch a little bit later. You are doing an excellent job. Okay, so we've got to spend a couple minutes on writing, because comics aren't just art, they are writing too. So if you take a look at a comic book and you try to guess how much of it is art and how much of it is writing, you would be surprised by how little space you have for actual text. And in fact, this is more text than I normally like, but I was trying to explain what gravity is here and it was kind of complicated. But the good news is that when you write a comic, you don't have space for a lot of words, and that's fine because you don't need a lot of words to tell a story. So here's an Aesop's fable called The Fox and the Crab. And it says, a crab one day grew disgusted with the sands in which he lived. He decided to take a stroll to the meadow not far inland. There he would find better fare than briny water and sand mites. So off he crawled to the meadow, but there a hungry fox spied him and in a twinkling ate him up, both shell and claw. Be content with your lot. So I totally disagree with the moral, but it's super short. It's 67 words, which is really incredible. It's such a short story. And you can get even shorter. This is some micro science fiction from Twitter, from this great account. So it says, excuse me, said the alien, but you appear to be leaking. Leaking? Oh no, I'm just crying. Crying? Sorry, it's a safety valve when the emotional load is too great. When that happens to us, one of our heads explodes. I think I prefer crying. I think I would too. So only 50 words. And you can get even shorter. So this is a famous 6-word story by Ernest Hemingway called, and it goes, For Sale, Baby Shoes Never Worn. And it's super famous, but it's not actually by Ernest Hemingway at all. It's by this guy, John DeGroote, who wrote it into a one-man play called Papa. And now no one knows who he is. And it's kind of too bad. But this great magazine called Smith Magazine took this idea and used it to inspire writing 6-word memoirs. So here are a couple of 6-word memoirs from famous people. So on the left, musician Aimee Mann says, couldn't cope, so I wrote songs. And on the right, Stephen Colbert says, well, I thought it was funny. So what we're gonna do now is you're gonna write 6-word stories of your life. So we're gonna give this a few minutes. And if you've got one all set, type it into the chat. And if you don't mind me reading it out loud, and then I'll read the ones out loud that you do. So here are a few that I wrote. So 6-word stories of your life, 6 words about any part of your life that you like, could be about your pets, could be about your friends. So mine are science or art, I chose both, childhood in Ottawa still slowly defrosting, and when birds fly, my heart soars. Let's see. Oh, wow, I'm already getting a whole bunch of really good ones. Okay, so we've got, let's see here, just trying to move around my windows. Oh, Lost Love Found Happily Ever After by Deb. Curious About Too Many Things, Darn by Celine. I totally get that. Oh my goodness. Catherine says wanted to do everything, so did. Tina says no time to nap, do it, which I like, but I also like napping. Steph says raised by hippies, obviously in Toronto. Let's see here. Oh, too much science, not enough art from Susanna. Gloria says, need more snow, move to Timmins. I love it. These are excellent. Let's see. Still looking for the life manual. Oh my goodness, these are incredible. Sophie says, I like taking pictures of birds. Oh. DJ says, well, seemed like a good idea. Oh, these are so good. These are so, so good. Let's see. Saw it all. Now what's next? Oh, these are wonderful. Birds, flowers, mammals, butterflies sustain me, says Margaret. Oh, these are excellent. Okay, wow. I didn't think we'd get this many so fast. This is really incredible. All right, so I just want to read these all day. Oh, Lee says, once I knew we all belonged. These are wonderful. Tina says, to the sea, oh, I feel that. All right, oh gosh, okay, these are all so good. Okay, so we're gonna move on to the next exercise, but wow, those are wonderful, thank you. Oh my goodness, I just feel all emotional. Okay, so six words is a super great exercise for learning brevity. And in fact, I used to write 55 word stories all the time to try to really learn to get a lot shorter. And this will actually help you. Ooh, I spoiled. Okay, ignore what you just saw. This will actually help you if you get into the movie or TV writing business, because there's this concept called log lines, which is a really short summary for the pitch of a movie or a TV series. And you basically shoot that at a producer, and then you get to make your movie, hopefully. So log lines are a really important thing. And I'm going to read this to you. Pretend you didn't see the picture that I just showed you by accident and try to guess the movie. So it says, a meek and alienated little boy finds a stranded extraterrestrial. He has to find the courage to defy the authorities to help the alien return to its home planet. So that's 29 words. Right. And of course, Malcolm has already guessed it's ET. So you know exactly what it is. And it's a 29 word story, which is really, really amazing. So since you're all so incredibly fast, I think we're going to do one more writing exercise, which is that you're going to describe your favorite movie in 10 words, and we'll try to guess what it is. So one of mine would be, she sailed away from her home to save her home. Does anybody know what that one is? Yeah, Matthew immediately guessed it's Moana. Excellent. Okay, so let's give this a shot. So try to describe your favorite movie in 10 words and then pop it in the chat and we'll try to guess what your favorite movie is. Matthew says, I was going to do that one too. I stole your movie. And if you don't feel like doing that, definitely scroll up and read some more of these six word memoirs, because they're really beautiful, just fantastic. Okay, Catherine has summarized my true favorite movie. Computer hackers become friends and save the world on rollerblades. Right, we all know what that is. It's Hackers, such a good movie. Okay, let's see what else we've got. Deb has stranded on Mars, survived to tell the tale. Okay. I think that would be The Martian, probably. Yeah. Let's see what else we've got. Guy goes to the digital world and breaks it. That has to be The Matrix, right, Andres? Yes. Kidnapped wives lead to a high stakes chase in the desert. Right. So that is Fury Road. I'm really surprised, because often I don't know what the movies are, but these are really, really good. Goes to war so her dad doesn't have to. Yeah. That's, why am I blanking on the name? The Disney movie. Mulan, yeah. Awesome. This is wonderful. Oh, Monica sent one that I don't recognize. He needed cheese, only one place to go, the moon. What movie is that? Oh, Wallace and Gromit. Yeah. So these are really, really excellent. Wait, they need to save their kingdom with surfing. Is that surf ninjas? Yeah. All right. Okay, these are wonderful. All right. So these may seem kind of silly, but of course I know about surf ninjas. So these may seem kind of silly, but they really are a super useful exercise because I find when people give me comics, sometimes, you know, comic scripts, they give me way too many words and they just don't know how few words you can actually have in there. Okay, I'll read one more. Let's see. Man, what have we got? Fly gets in the machine, authoritarians go after wrong guy. That'd be the fly. Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Okay. It's Brazil. Is it Brazil? It's been so long since I've seen Brazil. Okay. So we're going to move on. This was so excellent though. Oh my goodness. Okay. That was really, really great. So in the remaining minutes that we have, we're going to try to make a cartoon. And again, you might not be able to do a whole one in the time that we have left. When I do this with kids, just kids, not to intimidate you, but they're usually done in about 5 seconds, which is really impressive. So before we get started, though, I want to give you a little quick intro to a few things you need to remember when you're making a cartoon. So the first thing is, and a lot of you probably know this, but comics are made out of panels, which are these little squares or little circles or whatever, kind of separate sections. And I suggest that you make a four-panel comic. You don't have to, but I really have switched to making mostly four-panel comics, and there's a reason for that. It's a really nice, quick, easy shape. And also it's really easily shared online and emailed around because it's such a nice little compact square shape. So cartoonists, you know, used to go really vertical back when it was websites and you'd really scroll. And now a lot of us are sticking to this four panel shape, which I really, really like. And, you know, newspaper comics used to be three panels going across because that was how you read newspapers. So you really have to think about how people are going to read your cartoon. You don't have to stick to it. But it's something definitely to think about. So try drawing a grid of four squares just to get started. So a few other tips once you've drawn your four squares. So when you have creatures or people speaking in your comic, you can use speech bubbles, which are what we call these little shapes that have the words in them, and then the little tail that connects to the animal. And the most important thing to know about speech bubbles is make sure your text is big enough so that people can read it. Because so many times I come across a cool cartoon online, but the text is too small to be read on a phone or even to be read on a computer. And people often like to write really, really small, which we're taught, you know, when we're doing our notes. But in this case, it's really important to draw large enough so people can see, which takes away some of the space you have to put as many words as maybe you want, which is part of why we had that exercise earlier to try to get you to use fewer words. Another thing to know is don't start drawing immediately on your final paper. You know, sometimes you want to spend a little bit of time thinking about what your ideas are and where you want your characters to go. And in that case, you can draw what we call a thumbnail, which is when you sketch a really quick version of what you're going to be doing for your final cartoon. And what you should make your comic about is, Andres just said we're going to have extra 10 minutes for question. Great. Okay. So So what should you make your comic about? Well, think about something funny and interesting that animals do. And so I'm going to give you some funny birds for inspiration in case you can't think of one. So this is one of my favorite funny birds, the vulturine guinea fowl, which is a beautiful, colorful, lovely bird from about the neck, middle of the neck down. And then the rest of it is like a grumpy politician or a, you know, very, very surly, grumpy man. They always remind me of the Skeksis from the Dark Crystal. Another crazy bird. So I love albatrosses and I love the dances that they do. I wish humans had to do this every time we met up again after a long absence. So great. Beautiful job. Yeah, strutting. Okay, and last but not least, this is my all-time favorite silly bird video. So if you feel like doing a cartoon about these hooded grebes from Argentina, by all means do. So here we go. All pretty normal so far. Oh, that's great. I love the grebe in the back that's just sort of coming up to them like, what are you doing? Okay, so when you're making your cartoon, you can draw something about, you know, birds showing off, backyard wildlife that is maybe a little hungry and trying to steal from your bird feeder, funny baby animals you've seen. Feel free to make cartoons about your pets. And so, you know, normally I'd be in person and I'd be walking around checking out all your cool cartoons, and alas, that cannot be, but I'll have the gallery view open if anybody wants to show what they've drawn. And yeah, so enjoy. And also, I think it'd probably be all right if folks want to ask some questions while we're doing this, if anyone has any outstanding questions. This has been so much fun. You're all just doing such a cool job. Oop. Open up the chat. Oh, so Elena asked, can you share your book titles again? Oh, there's already a comic being held up. Ooh, let's see, I just want to zoom in on that. They say that the early bird gets the worm. Ah, oh, great, love it. Oh, hold on. All right, oh, excellent. Okay, so so I have a bunch of books. So I've got a graphic novel about the solar system, that is through the First Second Science comic series. That was my first one. I've got a collection of my comics called Birding is My Favorite Video Game, this little book of all my cartoons. Oh, some folks are heading out. Thank you so much for coming. Really, really wonderful to have you. So I also have the Atlas Obscura Explorer's Guide for the World's Most Adventurous Kid, which is a really hard book to say. And I was really impressed that Andre was able to say that one because it took me several months.
Latino.
Oh. And what else? Right. So the Butterflies Are Pretty Gross picture book just came out. Someone's holding up Burning is My Favorite Video Game. Yay. Thank you. That's wonderful. Yeah, so picture book, Butterflies Are Pretty Gross just came out. I'm really happy with it. The artist is Jacob Suva, and he's really wonderful. And then Pigeons is coming out this fall. And then I've got three more on the way. So if you go to rosemarymosco.com. There's a mailing list. You can sign up and keep up with all of those because they're all with different publishers. So it's a lot of keeping up with a lot of stuff. Somebody asked, so Anne asked, did you start out freelancing / self-publishing? Yes, but I was one of those people who started out working part-time at nonprofits and then doing this on the side. So I basically hung on to a job for a while until I was ready to move into doing creative stuff full-time, which I really enjoyed. I worked for some really cool nonprofits. But and did I start out self-publishing? Yeah, I spent years going to zine fairs and comic shows. There was this one in Toronto called Canzine that I think is still around that I used to go to every year. It was a really, really cool show. But that was more kind of stuff on the side. Oh, Canzine was this week, says Steph. Yeah, Canzine. I love Canzine. Anna says, may we email you? Yes, I'm at rmosco@gmail.com. And if this workshop inspires any comics, I want to see them. Because that makes me so happy. Let's see.
Rosemary, do you think we can open up the mic for folks to ask you questions?
Yeah, of course. Go right ahead.
Okay, so if you want to ask Rosemary a question, raise your hand or unmute yourself. Better if you raise your hand and then you unmute yourself and ask her a question.
Don't be shy.
So Elena says, my kids love your comics and request going to Bird and Moon all the time. They love birding. It's my favorite video game and have literally fallen off the couch laughing while reading it. I have to admit, that's the first book I bought from Rosemary. And I planned up this talk with her because I wanted to meet her and because she obviously was a remarkable speaker, but there was some selfish motivation there. I'm glad I was right.
We've got a question from, there's a cartoon here.
Magnus Eriksson over there has a raised hand.
Yes.
Go, Magnus, unmute yourself.
What is your favorite book you've written and what is your favorite bird?
Oh, such good questions. Oh, gosh. It's hard to pick a favorite book because I like all of them. I know that sounds cheesy, but they were all really fun in different ways. The one about pigeons that's coming out, I love, and it's the book that is most me. Like I came up with all of the ideas and I did all the art and stuff. So maybe the pigeons one, but you can't read it yet. This fall you can. Favorite bird changes every 5 minutes. I feel like I always say albatrosses, or Stellar Sea Eagle is also a really cool, super cool eagle. And I have two green cheek conures. So they're my favorites or not my favorites, depending on whether they have pooped on me in the last 5 minutes. Favorite software/program for creating art, Eva asks. So I just use Photoshop. I'm kind of old school. So I have a Wacom tablet and a stylus, and I just use Photoshop. I know a lot of people are using Procreate these days. It's really, really excellent. But I am just still really old school. Let's see. Ellen says, do you draw your comics on actual paper first? I used to up until really recently. And now I do it all on tablet. Oh, someone's holding up a comic. Let's see, can I look at it bigger? This is fine. Is this a This Is Fine bird? with the sun, that's better. Oh, that's so great. That's really great. I love it. Excellent.
So I want to give a quick shout out to the latest question from Ellen Jakubowski. She is the social media person for Birds Canada in communications. And so everything you see, every time you see something posted about Rosemary, an upcoming event, an image, a photo, it comes from her. So big thank you, Ellen. Big thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. You've done an amazing job. That is difficult stuff. Oh, someone says, I've seen plants highlighted beautifully in some of your comics. Do you happen to have a similar session for this one for plants? Oh, I wish I did. I don't. I always mean to draw new plants. That's definitely something to think about, though, because it'd be fun to talk about plant anatomy because it's just such a different thing. I actually have a botany degree, so I spent a lot of time learning plant anatomy. So that could be really fun. Oh, a few folks are holding up comics.
Oh, wait. I'm going to spotlight them. Oh, great. Let's start with this one.
Let's see. That's great. How dare they laugh when they're literally weird, mostly bald monkeys. That is thank great. You, so that's the patu from earlier.
Yeah.
Oh, great. I love
let's,
it.
Let's spotlight this one.
Oh, gosh. These are great. Oh, this one's a little hard for me to read because of the
camera. I can't read it either.
Oh, looks like a turtle.
Sorry. I didn't do the drawing very well.
No, no, the drawings are great. It's just hard, a little hard to see on the camera. Can you read it out for us?
I will destroy you. Die, Cookie. No. It's a joke about a joke that me, my sibling, and my friends made this afternoon on a walk we were going on.
Oh, nice. Are you going to show it to them?
Probably.
You definitely should.
Yeah.
In the meantime, while we see some of the cartoons, and before we end, I'm going to launch a poll. If you guys can take a minute to answer some of those questions, that will be awesome. Let me see. Oh, we have more cartoons. Let me spotlight this one.
Oh, we have so many. Life is a common loon. I like to spend summers in Canada. That may make me crazy, but not common. Life is a common loon. I love that. Oh, that's great. That's a very recognizable loon. I really like
this. It is a very good drawing.
Yeah.
Okay, let me see if I can spotlight another one.
Great.
I have one here. Is that what I think it is?
I'm angry existentially. Also at you. Not you, Rosemary. It's a wren.
Good job, Catherine.
They always look so mad. Oh, that's so good.
They always do look so mad.
They're so loud and they look so mad.
Okay, this one here.
Oh, that was brilliant.
Oh, but it's a bit out of focus. I don't know
if I can read it. Oh, sorry. Hold on, let me... I'll read it if that's okay.
Yeah, please do.
So, great drawing. This is actually... it's like really out of focus and kind of glary. But so it's two of those finches, that finch that uses like thorns to get bugs out of the thing.
Yeah,
and so one comes up to the other one and says, "What are you doing?" And in the second panel, the one using the thorn is saying, "Testing hypothesis. It looks like you're playing with sticks. Why, I, sir, am a scientist." is actually a joke that my friends, I was a paleontology undergrad for a little bit, a couple years, but and it was one of our jokes about animal science and how animals also do science by testing things like that.
Love that. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead, Rosemary.
I was just going to say that makes me think of False Knees. It really reminds me of False Knees comics.
Oh, yeah.
That guy is my hero. He's also so nice. I haven't met him in person, but we email a lot, and he's so great. Yeah, that was really funny.
Thank you.
I need an exploration. There's a finch that uses thorns to get bugs out of holes?
Yeah.
Like, that's for real?
Yeah, I can't remember where they live, but...
Are they Darwin finches? I'm trying to remember.
I think they are a Galapagos
finch. Yeah, I'm looking it up.
I can't remember where they were. I did like a... Yeah.
That is so awesome. Thank you for teaching me that.
Yeah, the woodpecker finch, one of Darwin's finches. Ooh, distracted birds, not hatchery. Okay. I have actually drawn this as a cartoon. So we are of the same mind. The same what? Mind.
That's so crazy.
Yeah. It's a, one of my older ones, but it's that. And then there's a third bird too. I think I did Sapsucker, Creeper, and Nuthatch. That's awesome.
It's some birding is my favorite game, right?
I think so.
Yeah, I think that's so.
Weird. I love how the birds that happens. Go down trees. It's clear we are simpatico.
That's so great because it almost happened outside my window. There's a tree here, and it was great to watch. Actually, a brown creeper and a lizard bonked the other day. A wall lizard. It was amazing. That'd be a good one too.
Oh my goodness, that is really cute. Yeah. Yeah, my comic had the trifecta of three different birds bonking, which I don't think has ever happened, but I kind of
have another one.
Oh, parrot. Let's see. Hello. Mom, I don't think he speaks English. That took me a second to read. Oh, I love it. The parrot.
He sits at the window every day and screams hello at all of the birds and gets very frustrated that they're rudely ignoring him.
Right. Oh, that's really sweet. And your bird's, it's an Amazon bird?
Yeah, he's a double yellow-headed Amazon. His name's Gino. I've got a parrotlet too, but he's off screen.
Oh, they are the feistiest little friends, boy.
Oh yeah, and the best.
Yeah. Oh, that was excellent. Thank you. So good.
All right. We have three more minutes before we finish our session, which has been absolutely awesome. We have one more comic coming. And please bring your questions to Rosemary.
Hey, you, happy birthday. Have a good day. Love you. Oh, well, that's quite sweet. I like that. What a cute bird. That's very, very cute.
Oh, there's two more. I'm going to start with this one.
Great. Let's see. Well, a little hard to read that one.
Yeah.
Never just heard. A robin, just a starling.
It says, hang on one second here.
We can listen to you, Rob.
So it's about how we, when we look at birds in the summertime, we're all very much, we want to see the good birds. So it says, just a robin. That's just a starling, just a sparrow. And it's the four, three of them say, they'll be happy to see us in January.
It's true. Yeah. I did a cartoon about that too with a cardinal that.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. It's true though. The winter, we're just desperate for any birds.
We have another one coming from Magnus. You might have to either put it closer to the camera or to remove your background.
I'm just trying to figure out how to remove the background. Sorry. Let's see if I can. Oops.
No. Chelsea, the parrot person. I wanted to mention
that's a really big eye.
Oh, look at that. Yeah.
Predator, and then it's like, oh please don't.
Oh,
hearts on it.
Oh, is that what's happening?
Yes.
Okay.
Hearts on the predator. Okay. Is that one of their actual defenses?
No.
Excellent farting bird. A+. Chelsea, I was going to mention, if you haven't read the cartoon Chicken Thoughts, you probably have. Okay, yeah, it's a parrot people cartoon. Magnus, that was great. any farting in a comic elevates
Thank
it.
You.
Like, perfect comic to me. So good.
Chelsea asks, what are your parrot names?
Oh, I'm kind of shy about sharing family details, sorry, but they're just we'll call them Bitey and Fighty for now. They're one is 10 and one is about 7, and they're my children, and soon I will rescue them from the evils of the carrier that they're in outside the door, where they're just neck deep in Nutriberries right now.
All right, I would like to give a tremendous thank you to all of you and your great comics and enthusiasm and energy, but also to our guest today, Rosemary Moscow, who I was so happy to have here. I was so happy to meet and to work with her in preparation for this event. Rosemary, I hope you had fun and that
I
we will have
so
you again.
Fun. Thank you. You did this flawlessly. I really appreciate all that.
And welcome back to Toronto. I hope next time, if you are passing through, we will have you in person. And remember, there are more events coming for the Toronto Bird Celebration. For full event calendar, go to www.torontobirdcelebration.ca. And until tomorrow, when we talk about finding nests with Ian Fife. Have a good night.
Exciting. Good night, everybody. Good night.